Okay, folks, we're going to move along, and this is the continuing invasion of West Australians. Jason Stevens is currently the leader of Restoration Ecology at the science director at Kings Park. That's the big national park in Perth and the Botanic Garden. And he's going to talk to us this afternoon. There you go.
First of all, thanks for people like Chris, really appreciate it for your conversations welcome to me. It's been very simple to get over here and this presentation out, so I really appreciate it. So I'm a scientist, if you want to pigeonhole me, scientist, so you must switch off at this point in time and to switch the rest of you off. I'm a plant physiologist, so what that means for me is I really like to understand how plants function in the environment. And so when we put it back, for me it's all about how the plants perceive what we're doing. And in thinking about the symposium today, I was trying to limit my physiological understanding to the recruitment bottlenecks of between the seed germination and early seedling establishment phase. Now that doesn't take me away from the broader picture and Kings Park's broader vision of trying to restore biodiversity generally across our landscapes. And in the last 10 years in particular, that's really been driven by the mining resource boom. And so today's talk, I was wanting to focus on a couple of different aspects of the native grasses, the triodiagominated systems of the north, but also some of the higher rainfall grasses that you guys have probably been speaking a little bit more about at the moment. But because I'm a bit of a science nerd, every now and then I get to let my hair loose and generate a whole lot of weird and wacky things. And I thought we would went to have a coffee break, so I thought I'd try and keep it a little bit tight as we go through and try to explain to you why the seed image in the middle there of Chloris truncata is probably the best looking seed patch you'll ever see. So we all know that grasses are an important component of our system, and as I said, a lot of our work recently has focused on the triodiagominated systems. More of that, almost the indigenous kind of central agricultural zone that we heard about this morning. And they're pretty obvious. The bottom left-hand image is a triodiagominated grassland. The other half of my time is spent working in and around Perth in the urban area. The bottom right-hand image shows Banksia woodland. You'll be doing very well to actually pick a native grass in that system, in the extant population. But when we get disturbance events come through there, the whole system changes pretty rapidly. So here's basically a monoculture of an Ostracyber compressor. It's only an annual grass, but it dominates in that first year, or maybe two. I'm really interested in how it facilitates the rest of the development of the biodiversity in the national land, which has several hundred species sitting in there. Why is all that important? Well, in WA, there's a huge risk of biodiversity loss. A recent report from the Environmental Protection Authority, the regulatory body which governs mining, really isolated the cumulative impact in the Pilbara zone. So what you can see there on the map on the left is everything that's green, which is about 6%, is intact national park. The really light yellow is stuff that isn't under tenement. And then everything else, which is about 95% of the Pilbara, is actually under a mining tenement at the moment. Okay? The clearing that happened between 97 and 2010 is about 2,500 square kilometres. There's about 1,900 square kilometres proposed up there in the immediate future. But we haven't even accounted for what happened in the 30 to 40 years previous. So there's a lot of pressure in this system. When the mining companies go to restore that system, the regulators are now aware that everyone's kind of failing. It's probably about 15% electricity return on the whole. Okay, so things aren't working. Banksia woodlands in and around Perth, we're seeing exactly the same kind of trends. This is a map just put together by the federal government from the Banksia woodland extent in 1780, and that's what it looks like now. So decimation of intact Banksia woodland systems, and what we can see is there's going to be more pressure on Banksia woodlands. And as of last month, they were finally recognised at the federal level as being a threatened ecological community. Perth has an ambitious plan to double in population size by 2050. So we're going to be putting in that pressure in this system. Now, why is restoration absolutely critical? A few examples from Western Australia. See what happens. I've got three examples there from the arid zone, the semi-arid zone, sitting on the edge of the wheat belt, and then the Mediterranean zone in and around Perth. The top two have been impacted by, that's the intact state. A mining process will then occur over a 5 to 10 year period, rebuild their waste dumps. And in the Mediterranean zone, the example I've chosen here is from the pine forestry, which basically planted pines 20 years later. Remove the pines and then see what happens. So 5 years to 10 years after that, this is what the landscape's kind of look like. The top image doesn't look too bad in terms of cover, but what you see there is a predominance of upper grass introduced species. There's a few acacias that are in the system, but not a lot. In other systems, it can be quite stark. What's left behind in the middle image is just basically a bare waste rock dump. Not a lot of seed when it into the system, no plant recruitment. The bottom image, again, a lot of plant cover, but that's it, hard to upbuild grass, almost 100% cover. Issues if you leave the systems alone. Then you proceed down to the 20-year time frame. It's pretty difficult to get some of these images. You're either left with a barren wasteland if you don't do any restoration, or you're left with a few species that may dominate, and most of them will not be in the weeds. Okay. So our business is about trying to plan back into some of these systems before they get on a trajectory where you're going to see complete failure. So the mining sector up until recent times has been in the mindset of, okay, let's just put out some seed and see what happens. Okay, that's been happening for 20, 30 years. And it's only recently, with the EPA saying that actually 85% of Americans are failing, have we started to document where those recruitment failures are happening. And I've just pulled out three examples here to show that it's across Western Australia, but people are also seeing it internationally as well. The Pilbara example that I have here shows that we probably have about 80% loss, 70 to 80% loss in the germination phase. If you throw a seed out, 30% may actually germinate. Whereas in the United States, they don't have that same bottleneck at that particular point in time. Theirs comes in between germination and emergence phase. And that's where they're getting about 60-70% loss. And in the southwest zone, it's probably a combination, mainly about 50% at germination stage, and then more in the established zone where we see lots of losses. So for us, and as a scientist, I like to try and quantify what's going on. And for business, they like to see how much money they're wasting, really, and how much improvement they can make in their efficiencies. So a couple of back-of-the-envelope calculations, these are very conservative. For BHP over the next 20 years, there's probably about 10,000 hectares they need to acquire. Average costs, $100 a kilo of the seed, about $64 million. But it's really the loss, which is they're quite concerned about. It's up to $55 million if they'll just throw the seed out at the moment. It's going to be wasting a lot of money. They're now taking notice. We have significant research programs in place just to address this issue. I think around Perth, there's opportunities to restore about 15,000 hectares of Banksia woodland. The cost of seed there is phenomenal, $260 million US, about $1 million just to restore using seed alone, using a moderate level of seed. Something that's already come up before is the collection capacity of some of our native seed. I mean, we may require hundreds of tonnes, but on the whole Swan Coastal Plain, we're probably looking about a tonne of seed collected annually across the whole area. Large challenges. Which leads me to think about the first bottleneck of actual recruitment. That's where to collect seed from. It's been touched on already. But think about the Pilbara. There's not a lot of free land out there. In the Pilbara itself, there's also regulations in place where seed must be collected within 100 k's of the impact site. So you're really focusing the collection efforts down into landscapes where there might not necessarily be large quantities of seeds available regularly. We have pretty sporadic rainfall occurring through those systems, but also a lot of the species may be restricted to certain parts of the landscape. Taking it back even one step, challenges to even identify what seed you're collecting. Now, this example I'm showing here is actually a current mining activity. The information I'll provide is probably only a couple of weeks old. But something around even just identifying this Charoidea species, we're all gone. Now, the reason why this is important is that the company, through the regulatory process, is now being instructed to collect the three species that were originally identified there, which means they're driving 50 miles to collect seed that may be used in restoration efforts at that site, even though it doesn't exist there. So being able to just identify impacts is a large challenge in some of these environments. And then if you can identify your plants, you need to really understand what differences might actually occur within that species itself in any given landform. Now, something that we were only discussing last week, and I thought it was worthwhile just throwing out there, more to get some input from other people that may have more experience in this area, is the issue of poidial, so the number of chromosomes that each population plant would have in the population. What we can see with Troodia in a 100k radius is that it's the same species, but certain populations seem to favour one type of poidial level compared to another. And they seem to be linked geographically. And why is this important? Because sometimes when different poidial levels get together, you can have unintended consequences. Okay? So this is some work, granted it's from the US, Bluebell, you couldn't get any further away from them and they have a grasp, but it could be challenging to find information like this. But it's a theory that we would like to test. And that is if you cross either a diploid with a diploid, so if you've got two pairs of chromosomes in each, that's the grey bar on the left hand of each of the graphs, or if you cross a tetraploid with a tetraploid, so you've got four copies of each chromosome, that's the grey bar on the right. And then if you force them to cross in between each other, they're the two open bars in the middle, what happens to fruit set, seed number per fruit, and germination? And what we can see is it can be somewhat disastrous. When poidial levels get together, but even if we had to pull out one thing, look at germination, bottom graph, you're going from a system that can potentially germinate to 70% to something that may only germinate to around 2-3%. Now this is in a very germinable plant species. If we're taking something like Troodia, where we're only getting 15-20% germination to begin with, what does that mean for germination consequences into the future? So the first barrier that I thought would come up with is seed supply. We've heard a lot about it today, but more so on the taxonomy. Some of our grasses, it's far from resolved, and it's not until we actually get into some of these areas do we get a real good appreciation of our native grass diversity. And something else that may need to be considered, I'm not saying that it hasn't been considered already, but at least for Troodia, may need to be considered is the population-specific trait. Before we go sourcing seed from all over the place and throwing it together and then seeing potential failures, maybe we have an appreciation for what we're dealing with before we think about composite provenance and the like. But anyway, I'm here to really think about a seed. We throw it out onto the surface. Why does 85% of it fail, basically? And some work from a PhD student of mine looking at Troodia establishment. I'm only going to present one species today, but there's other species that we've worked through. We really looked at how we can manipulate seed dormancy, which I've heard a little bit about before, and how that interacts with rainfall scenarios. And the reason for this is people are questioning the need to think about dormancy, to clean down the pure seed, and to me it's all about getting the numbers and the data behind it before we can make an informed decision about what we should be doing with our seed and how it interacts with various conditions we're throwing it into. So the three dormancy states we created were the florets. We treated them as the most intact. They germinated to about 40%, a reasonably slow germination rate compared to the other treatments. The moderately dormant species, Alice is where we use some of the wet-dry cycling, where we expose conditions of a couple of days wet and dry it back, and a couple of days of wet and dry it back, to really think about that aging process of the seeds. And then we had our least dormant clean seeds. It was just three arbitrary classifications that we came up with, and three things that the industry may be able to do. We then put it out across the field site, a whole range of different rainfall frequencies, which were reflective of a different percentile recordals of rainfall that the pure rock actually exists, that it receives. And we counted out, I'm using the royal way here, but with the PhD student counted out a hell of a lot of seeds. Bagged them up, buried them to quantify germination, and for other ones, we just sow directly into lines to look at emergence. Okay. So the advantage of using buried seed is you can retrieve it at certain intervals, rip them out, see what's actually germinated, look at it for yourself, and then compare that to what's been emerged. It helps you to understand the difference between where the limitation may be in the system. Put on a whole heap of water, thanks to BHP for their support with that. And so what did we find? Well, basically, I'll quickly talk you through this graph because you can only see a couple of bars there. But we have a response on the y-axis, and then on the x-axis we either have florets, the first set of bars, wet-dry cycle florets in the middle, and then the seeds on the end. What we can quickly see is that you need a quite regular rainfall event, so we'll get the bars on the very right-hand side, the graphs on the very right, 4x24 and 4x12 events are really the only ones that stimulated any kind of germination and any kind of emergence, and it was limited to seeds. Okay, so the seeds were the only thing that were able to come up after simulated rainfall events, which occurred very rapidly in the Pilbara Don't Get Me, after a week long worth of rainfall and monitored for 4 weeks. Now, it's not new that seeds seem to be a little bit more proactive in their germination and emergence phase, but what we're able to do is to link how the different dormancy stages germinate under water stress. And this was something that took us by surprise. So the y-axis here of the germination fraction, and the x-axis is basically the amount of water stress that we put the plants under. Okay? The left-hand side is perfectly wet conditions, going to the right-hand side where it's extremely dry. What we're able to see is that seeds can actually persist in drier environments or germinate in drier environments better than florets or the wet-dry florets, which kind of goes against a little bit of what I was taught and kind of a little bit against my thinking, but this is the data that we're starting to generate for some of these species. And because of that ability to germinate in slightly dry conditions, it actually gave them the potential to capitalise on some of this rainfall to get their roots down and to begin to establish where the floral material did it. Now, clearly there's a trade-off between do you want plants to come up instantaneously and capitalise on small rainfall events, or do you want them to remain dormant? Now, what we're replicating here is extremely large rainfall events. So if they're not going to be germinating here, it's going to be challenging for them to germinate in that season. More so, we had a look at what was left behind. So out of those germination bags, we looked what had germinated, but then we looked at what hadn't germinated, and then we took them back to the lab, cut them open to see if they were still viable. And what we're able to show you across the board, no matter if it's a floret or a seed, everything dropped down to about a 60% viability after 4 weeks. So throwing out a floret or throwing out a seed after 4 weeks, almost half of your seed preserves are decimated out of the seed bank. What that means for longer term persistence, I don't know. We're gathering the data at the moment, but the anecdotal evidence is that some of the seeds should be able to last for at least a year in the system, but we're trying to get the data to underpin some of those assumptions that we're making about the arid zone. So for us, cleaning may create more tolerant seeds and may underpin emergent success. But more importantly, for you to address seed dormancy and the impact on short-term establishment success, in the arid zone you have to capitalise on those short-term environmental events, or you risk failure. And for the mining companies, this is particularly critical because with the regulators, they also have, it's not just about getting biodiversity back into the system, but it's usually time frames with which you have to hit targets. So some of the companies that I work with, after 5 years of finishing mining or extracting, they have to hit a certain target. Okay, so we can't just sit by and see how the system goes for 3 or 4 years. We need to give it a chance to recruit at least, you know, every year. Before we get to that 5-year mark, because that's at the point where they need to report back to the regulators. If that's completely unrealistic, at least we'll have the science to say to the regulators, maybe that 5-year time frame isn't quite adequate for an arid zone, maybe thinking 10 or 15 years, something. We And there's various reasons for planning C, not just to germinate a little quicker, but it becomes a little bit easier to handle in terms of flowability. You're able to treat your seed, but also you can decrease seed weights and seed mass pretty quickly as well. So, Mal's mentioned before about the challenge with planting seed mechanically is that you may actually disturb the embryo from the rest of the endosperm. And here's an example of Microlena. You've got an intact flora, top left, going down to plain seed, but when we look at it under a microscope, the image on the right shows that the embryo has actually been removed. So the fun we had was with acid. I put on a hat to say, well, if we can't mechanically clean something, I might have a go with some acid. So I tried 18 molar of complex sulfuric acid and saw how some seeds responded. And the other guys tried some flaming treatments. I'll fly through these because I'm going to run out of time. But what we're able to show is for each of these graphs, you see germination percentage on the y-axis and treatment duration of three different concentrations of acid, which are at the top, either 50%, 70% or 100%. Where you see the open symbol, that's where we could actually see the intact seed that had been removed from the flora. With Microlena, we could see that we could increase the germination and we could remove it successfully from the flora using acid. Chloris, a beautiful seed, a little bit more susceptible to acid. We could use lower concentrations for longer durations, and the same with Rhodonosperma, lower concentration, we could successfully extract the seed. High concentration was completely detrimental. And for Themeda, it was a dormant seed batch, made no difference to germination. But we could get there, we could clean it up, so that was a positive. I'm not going to focus anymore on the germination and dormancy enhancement work that we've been doing. I'm happy to have a conversation with anyone around that for species specific stuff a little bit later on. So I thought, how else can we torture seeds? Well, we gave it to some engineers and had a bit of fun. So we had a little seed coating machine, and we thought, well, maybe we could burn these things off. And these guys are saying, well, how about we go to 1800 degrees? How does that work? Okay, let's have a go. But it's funded at really high revs, so each seed is probably only getting hit by, because it's at 0.08 seconds of extreme heat as it flew around. We've since scaled up, so we're now able to at least handle tens of litres of seed, but it's still at the development phase, the conceptual phase. Now this isn't going to work because I tried it before, but you can just imagine a flame licking the florets off the thermometer as it flies around. It looks spectacular. If you really want to see it, I'll show you on my computer. But this is what the seed looks like at the end of it. You go from floral material down to something that's removed the hairs and some of the appendages in Trodea. Doesn't really impact the germination potential. What it does do is that it reduces the volume significantly, up to 50% volume reduction on your seed batch. So all of a sudden you're not dealing with usually a hand, the wool bales full of gear, unless you can get that down to a more manageable level, and you're dealing with a lot less weight, about 25% less. Microlena, I thought I'd better throw that through the mix. We can flame it for 15 minutes, it survives okay, it germinates exactly the same as a floret, so it's not removing any dormancy or anything, it's just helping to get rid of the awns and make it a lot more manageable. Which then allows us to, I don't know if this will work either, it doesn't, I'll just keep going, allows us to coat it and then put it through machinery. Okay, so that, we're all geared up around how can we get seed to fit in with existing machinery. The next thing that I'll just, if I've got 1 or 2 minutes, right, 1 minute, is when we've got clean seed, what can we then do to really empower the seed, seed itself? And something that we've been looking at is seed priming, okay, which is a fancy term for the amount of seed, which given the amount of time. We can control the hydration of that seed using different solutes, and basically the top image was my design using a couple of milk bottles. But then we go up to the engineers and we can now scale up, where you basically put seeds into a bubbling osmolite solution. We can then add germination enhancers. We produce things like carotenoid, which is the active ingredient in smoke from bushfires. And we can put that in the mix above those seeds for however long we want. Clearly, if it's water, things might last for 12 hours, but maybe if you use other more concentrated solutions of osmolite, you can go for days. It really empowers the seed through the activation phase before they get put out into the real world. And this is the real world, and this is what we've seen up in the Pilbara. So to explain some of the coding there, and the y-axis is emergence. We've got florets, the FL. S is seed plus coating, seed plus priming, and seed plus priming coating. We can see that if we prime trolley seeds for 12 hours using a couple of anti-chemicals, we can get the emergence up from an extremely dormant patch from zero in the florets up to 40%, following a significant rainfall event. So that's only 20 minutes, which is on the high levels. We destroy seeds on the surface, however, no matter what, however we manipulate the seed, life becomes a lot more challenging. So I have a really good appreciation for all the economic research that's been happening in this room, and that's what I always need to take back from these conferences. We can come up with some really wonderful things, but if we don't understand where it needs to be placed in the broader environment, then it's a few moments and challenges. So seeds and seed solutions get you so far, you can't then just expect the seed to work here and also kind of throw it out on the seed. And this is what some of the lines may look like. Probably hard to see, but trust me, there's some green patches there. We're now scaling up in the Pilbara. I'll sort of leave you with these couple of slides to say we're not just looking at a couple of trophy species, we're looking at 34 target species, which is the highest priority stuff for the BHP, including 11 grasses, which is fibre. Charodia, we've selected them on a whole heap of criteria, built some pretty good controlled environment facilities up there where we can create different soil profiles, we can see different species into them. More importantly, we can look at substrate, rainfall interactions, and our seed interactions. While leaving with that, it looks like a nice veggie patch, but these are all the Arizona species that we're trying to get back into that system of which grasses are. Thanks.
Microgreens for the miners. Okay.